Hello, good afternoon, and thank you for the people that is still here on a Friday afternoon. First of all, I want to introduce what we talk about women who use drugs, how we began. Normally, when we talk about the war on drugs, we always imagine at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th, against the Chinese population with the war against opium, or in the 50s, because the cannabis with the Mexican, or the LSD in the 60s. But when we talk about women, we have to remember that the war on drugs began really earlier. In the Middle Ages, they were using the same plants that now are in the base of the modern pharmacology, as cannabis, opiates. Then they were using the plants not just for individual reasons or for the lack of pain, but for the wellness. For the wellness of themselves as the community, for reproductive health, to control the pregnancy, etc., etc., etc. Then they were burned. The women that were burned in Catalonia for using these plants as a remedy or as a poison were called medineras. And I explain that because it is the name of our program in Barcelona. It was there that the stigma against women who use drugs began to be built. Or they were criminalized, or they were eroticized, or both. It's still going on, no? When you see the cannabis propaganda, for example. And of course, we use drugs. We produce drugs, and it's a huge difference when you are white and you are working in the States, or you are from Latin America or Asia, and you are planting coca leaves or poppy plants. Also, we sell drugs. Do you know who is La Dama Blanca? I am pretty sure that everybody, she's the one that was passing cocaine to the States inside the hills before nobody was doing that in Colombia. Nobody knows her, because normally when women have relations with risk practices, we are more discreet and we do it better. What they have in common is that they were single moms, they were poor. Do you know her? But I'm sure that everybody knows Pablo Escobar. She is who teach Pablo Escobar how to do the things. He didn't learn really good. But yeah, the thing was they were coming, all of them, from poor communities. These women were the ones that were selling alcohol in the States also during the prohibitions. Then what they find is that selling drugs, they were really successful making money, things that they cannot do in a legal way. Also, we use drugs, and normally, in the 85% of the cases, we don't have problems with our drug use. Really similar with the male population. I want to show you this video. It was made for women that impacted by the war on drugs around the world.
Canto y cuento abajo el gobierno, rápido y lento, los días que nos pasan y nos pisan. Adiós sonrisas, la sensación de abrigos y sonrisas. Nos quitamos las camisas, nos dormimos, nos inventamos, nos encontramos, pero ante todo. te añoramos. Una vida, una ida sin vuelta, envuelta en la pérdida como la ruina. Eres miedo, dolor, amor, recuerdos, como un vaso sin hielo, como besar el mar muerto. Y ya sabes que lo siento. Ese llanto que nos guarda en la despedida, y así serás. Agua, viento, sol y libertad, y libertad, y libertad. Abrimos el pulmón y lloramos por la libertad. Eres ese miedo que tanto he tenido, eres ese llanto que tanto he sufrido. Eres todo lo que he cantado y ahora, amigo, te digo, al cielo, las manos al cielo, al cielo. Las manos al cielo, al cielo. Que recorre mi intestino crudo.
Of course, women, when we use drugs, normally we don't have problems. But when we have, we are excluded of all the services, the general ones, but also of the specific ones. If you go to services, harm reduction services, we only represent 15%. And sorry, when I am talking about women, I also including non-binary gender folks. When we go to the harm reduction services, we just represent 15% of the population. Our specificities are not taken into account, and our needs are not taken into account, and normally they are not safe places for us. When we go to services for women surviving violence, we are expelled because we use drugs. It's because that we experience a lack of alternatives, a lot of barriers, a lot of institutional gaps, and all of these exacerbate the inequality and vulnerability that we are surviving, because we survive a lot of violence. Prejudice and stigma are also in the base of the systematic violation of our rights. It's because that we opened at Medineras. Medineras was the first cooperative only for women and gender non-conforming people who use drugs, with an holistic we wanted to make sure that the women were in the center, that we included full spectrum of harm reduction, but also that we are not doing just assistentialism, but activism. It's because that we focus in human rights and gender mainstream, or feminism, as you want to say. We wanted to be really flexible, because and also not addressing just the needs, but the expectations, the concerns, the interest of the women. Because we know that the needs are just the base, but if we want to fight for our rights, we need to be brave, and we need to focus on the needs and the interest. We need to project ourselves. We also are part of the community. We don't define ourselves as a service. We are part of the community, because finally we are neighbors. What defines you as a neighbor? That you pay a rent, or that you live in the neighborhood? Because a lot of times, we are finding that, oh, the neighbors don't want these women or these people living in the streets. But we are the ones that make the life there. We wanted to do it that from a really, really innovative point of view, because we saw that a lot of the people that was using the harm reduction services were doing the same for the last 20 years. We really were able to maintain the people alive, but we didn't make a room for them to make a living, to develop a real wellness. Then we are not inventing the wheel, but we were doing something really new. And it's because that we really need to be really creative. We wanted to show that the population that we were working with could trust us. It's because that we really practice the radical terness. We know that resilience is not individual, it's collective. We needed to have courage, because we were opening consumption room, but not defining us as a consumption room, but just including the consumption rooms inside a community service or a community space. We wanted to make sure that we were doing activism of care, that the care is taken into account inside the solidarity economy. From complicity and mutual support, also because we know that the problems are not the drugs, but the prohibition, We have a really commitment with anti-prohibitionism, and we are really serious about showing that what we are doing is really working. And we want to change the drug policy that now is based in social injustice and social control. Then we really have a transformative passion. We welcome to all the women that Fir alluded, trying to adapt to their realities and their complexities. As soon as you take away the drug use as a barrier, you can see that the main problem is not the drugs. The main problem is the multiple situation of violence and vulnerability that they are living. And we are talking about that half of them are sex workers, but mostly 70% are doing sex for survival. Most of them are homeless. A lot of them are roofless, but most of them don't have a safe place to sleep or to rest or to take a shower. All their it implies that all their life is 24 hours. You are in the street, everything. The people can see everything about you. Then you don't have any kind of intimacy or privacy. 40% of our population is LGBTQ, with all the transphobia that they have to survive. 30% are racialized, and most of them, around 50%, they have migratory experience, which means that more isolation, more loneliness. I will say, it says that 60% lost of custody. I want to clarify this data because most of them don't lose custody. They give custody away to other familiars because they are good moms and they want to make sure that their children are okay. Then they give the custody to other family members normally and sometimes to the state. But they are responsible moms. We began thinking that we will have around 40 women at the end of the year. Was the proportion of the harm reduction participants was similar than the consumption room here, around 15%. But when we opened it after a few years, we have already 370 women and between 35 and 45 visits per day. Most of them are cis women, but as you can see, we have a lot of trans women and also a lot of non-binary people. When we talk about what kind of drugs they are using, we are talking especially about polyconsume. And you can see here that most of the women combine legal and non-legal drugs. And this combination sometimes, for me is really interesting is, for example, to see the methadone programs. No, they go to methadone and a lot of them feels that it's really problematic that they use. It's not a solution just. And it's not because the substance, it's because the politics that surround the methadone programs. They have to arrive to a certain time. They have to, if they are late, maybe they're gonna lose their dose. They cannot decide how much methadone they want to take. They cannot quit where they want. Then for them, this is really, really problematic. Instead, we have the cannabis that a lot of them use to reduce harms from related to other kind of drug use. Then we can see that legal and illegal is not always problematic or not problematic, as you have been repeating all day. What we see is that 100% of the women that come to Medicineras have been surviving violence. They are overrepresented towards the survivors during childhood, the violence during childhood, but also they have been surviving a lot of violence during adulthood, not just because they're partners, but also because the nervy context for by strangers. If you want to sleep, if you are sleeping in the streets, it's really easy to be raped. Also, they are surviving institutional or structural violence. They go to the doctor and it's like, oh, I have headaches today. And they are like, oh, this is because you are taking drugs. No, I have been taking drugs the last 30 years and today I have headaches. No, but for them it's really difficult to be attended in a proper way. Also because the criminalization. They go to the streets, they were stopped and charged because the police, the judicial system, And when they go to jail, the jails are not made for anybody, but especially they are not made for women, no? They have less programs, they have to share the room with a lot of other women, etc., etc. What we want to do, or what we wanted to do, and we are doing already, is that we are locating the women in the center. They are the ones who decide what is what they want, what is what they need, and always working towards the agency, the empowerment, and the improvement of their wellness, whatever it means for each one. And normally, what they want to focus is not the drug use, is housing, is toxic relationships, is all of this. Of course, we need to focus on the basic needs, because if you don't have the basic needs covered, it's really difficult to fight for your rights, as I told you before. Also, we wanted to work towards reducing the barriers and improve access and adherence to the rest of the networks. They need to be diversified, they need to be comprehensive and appropriate, and also easy to navigate and have a high quality that is really far away of what is going on right now. Also, we are convinced that women who come to our place are the real experts of the realities. They need to be part of the design, the implementation, the monitoring and the evaluation of any politics or practices that are focused on their or can condition their lives. Then they are part of our team from the beginning, but also we are trying to make sure that every time that a law is done or a public policy is done, they are part of this process. And we love to go to the streets. And we like to work against the stigma and also for the rest of the, and we are connected with the rest of the struggles in the city, against gentrification, because it impacts directly our lives, but also the feminist movements, but also the drug movements or the anti-prohibitionist movements that normally don't take into account the particularities and the specificities of the women. What we wanted to do in that sense was to develop different sheltered of environments, and don't understand the sheltered of environments as a physical space, but mostly as an idea where they feel welcome, where they can develop their interests, and where they can share knowledge between each other. Because this is one of the main things that we did in Medineras, was to build a safe place for them where they can be friends. When we began first of all with a network of women who use drugs, and was really surprising to see that for the first time, was the first time that they could share, not feeling judged, and being open about their drug use, being open about their strategies or survival. A lot of them you don't want to know because they are not politically correct, but it's the only way that they can be alive these days, no? Because one of the things when you ask them is, I lost everything because the drugs. It's like, yeah, but you did something great because you are alive and most of your friends are not here anymore. They are in jail or they are dead. Then what did you do right? And just to make sure and to give value to their past was an important step. And be able to share this knowledge and know that this knowledge has a value was really crucial for them. Then just to have this space where they have different ways to participate, to make sure that they are represented and that their value has been also really, really important. We did these different shelters of environment. One is the cover, is the basic needs. They can come, they can use any of the drugs that they want to use. They can inject, they can snort, they can drink, they can smoke. And normally, the moment that they are injecting is the moment that we can talk about housing, is the moment that we can talk about toxic relationships, because they have been running all the day. They have been going to the dealer, or first they have to have the money that normally they don't have. They have to ask for money, they have to... We will see if the video works, thank you. Then one of the things is that we include consumption rooms inside of place, but this is not the center. There are a lot of workshops going on. There are theater, radio, etc., etc. Also, we do feminist self-defense, but also we share a lot of strategies of survival, as I was telling you. We participate in all the activist and community action that we have in our neighborhood, but also inside the social movements. They are really creative and artistic. Then we try to give room to all of this. Also, I will try to show you.
Somos consumidoras, pero aunque seamos consumidoras, no dejamos de ser personas. Nos podemos relacionar, podemos trabajar, podemos tener hijos, podemos tener amantes, podemos tener maridos, podemos poder ir a casa, puedo fregar platos y puedo tomarme drogas.
Hola, ¿os puedo hacer una pregunta, por favor? ¿Cómo es el trato con la gente que consume droga, la percepción que tenéis ahora? Y la que teníais anteriormente, claro.
Ha sido radicalmente diferente, sí, de alguien que no conocíamos de nada hasta saber los nombres, ¿no?
Reconocernos, de bromear, ser vecinas también, ¿no? Compartir relajadamente un espacio que no nos imaginábamos antes.
Hola, Carmen. ¿Cómo ha cambiado la opinión de las vecinas desde que se hacen proyectos en conjunto con vecineras?
Yo creo que es muy, muy positivo. Ahora he tenido la oportunidad de poder estar más cerca de vosotras y aún más veo que los resultados son maravillosos, ¿no? Este confinamiento ha sido muy potente para ver cómo funcionáis y cómo colaboráis entre vosotras y cómo colaboran las vecinas con vosotras, y creo que ha sido maravilloso, ¿no? Entonces, más no puedo decir, estoy encantada con vosotras.
Nosotras estamos encantadas con la mano que tiene Carmen para cocinar, que nos ha aportado ricas comidas y ricos postres. Gracias, Carmen.
¿Cómo ha sido la llegada de vecineras al barrio con su trabajo comunitario?
Pues mira, yo al principio no sabía muy bien, no lo conocía, cuál era el trabajo que hacían, pero yo creo que es fundamental para las mujeres que usan drogas tener un sitio donde se les acoja, se les cuide, se les mime, la pueda ver el médico. Vecinera ha hecho visible que la gente que usa droga son gente tan normal como cualquiera, con un problema como cualquiera tiene el suyo. Y que bueno, que lo menos que podemos hacer es apoyarla y darle visibilidad. Yo ahora no veo una drogadicta, veo a Susana, a todas por su nombre, porque las conocemos. Y bueno, a mí me parece que eso ya es un gran cambio.
Gracias por responder.
Dice así, supe construir un lugar donde vivir, así que nadie me va a convencer de que me tengo que ir. No me voy a ir, esta es mi casa, ven y pasa, miremos desde la terraza. Cuando te miro todo, todo se me pasa, no hay nada contra la fuerza de nuestra raza. Yo te convido si te falta, a mí me sobra mucha grasa.
Norte, ¿qué opinas sobre Mecherela?
Pues que sois un grupo muy alegre, que hacéis cosas muy interesantes, muy buenas para el barrio, para el mundo. Para mí lo importante es que las personas, consumidoras o no en general, sean dueñas de su cuerpo, de su vida y sobre todo que tengan salud.
¿Y cómo cambia el barrio desde que Mecherelas aparece por aquí, por el Ágora?
Cuando entra un colectivo como Mecineras en estos espacios, entramos en contacto personas que igual de otra manera es más difícil. Porque hay prejuicio, porque tenemos miedo, porque no conocemos al otro o a la otra. Y entonces cuesta mucho relacionarte. Y este espacio es fantástico para que nos conozcamos, para que haya esa mirada de ida y de vuelta. Y es fantástico.
Señores y señoras, para mayores de 18 años, rico, rico, fácil, fácil, para toda la familia. Rico vecinaje, Noah al micro.
Hola, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo está todo, guapa?
Soy Luana Monteiro, soy reportera de Mecinera. Estamos aquí en el barrio de Raval para ver cómo los vecinos aceptan la entrada a un nuevo grupo llamado Mecineras.
Me parece un espacio súper bonito y súper necesario en el barrio, porque es una realidad que existe. Son situaciones que te podrían pasar a ti.
¿Qué te gustó más de todo?
Hostia, la energía que hay, el buen rollismo, la sanidad que hay entre vosotras, la sororidad que hay entre vosotras y cómo os cuidáis y cómo os tenéis presentes, teniendo en cuenta que seguramente hay momentos que no habéis estado de todo bien, pero oye.
Nos hemos sentido súper cómodas aquí haciendo un evento con vosotras y haciendo un montón de cosas, que es una forma también de interseccionar muchas luchas, ¿no? O sea, contra la transfobia, anticapitalista, antifeminista, contra el estigma de las drogas y claro, que al final sí, estamos todas en la misma lucha.
En el momento que nosotros entramos aquí, había un poco de estigma. Se consumían drogas, si no consumía drogas, ¿qué íbamos a hacer? Cosas así, ¿no?
Sí, bueno, porque de hecho así de primeras a la gente es algo que le tira para atrás. Asocia consumo de drogas con mala gente. No es así, ¿no? Ya lo demostráis vosotras. Vuestra presencia aquí pues ha hecho que mucha gente pues vea el consumo de drogas de otra manera.
Yo creo que esto tienen que ser ensayos para un tipo, para una futura sociedad realmente libre, donde establezcamos un tipo de relaciones humanas, solidarias, libres, de mucho respeto de todos los unos con los otros y las otras, y de saber arrimar el hombro cuando cualquiera lo necesite.
No se olviden, beber también es droga, fumar también es droga, somos todos iguales y todos vamos a morir igual, ¿vale? No se olviden.
Que nadie quede afuera debería ser un decreto, le saco la careta a este gobierno y su secreto. No quiero más policía.
I will invite you to go to our YouTube page because it's really interesting the impact that has this this initiative. When we began in the middle of a conflict with the neighbors around the bad called narcopisos. The narcopisos were places where the dealers were selling drugs, and they were using inside with a lot of problems for the neighbors, the dirty, the noise, the fights, a lot of people being beat there. And the only solution that they were giving was the police. We wanted to make sure that we could provide with other solutions, no? And we did that. We began to do a paella every Friday in a community garden where we invited all the neighbors. We began to be involved in the debates. We began to make sure that we were doing our radio every week, making sure that the women were heard and also that they were part of the solution. We began to interact with the neighbors. And one of the testimonies here that I really like is one of the neighbors saying, before I didn't know about them. I just was talking about them around, they are drug users. They are sleeping in the street. They are a problem. Now I know everybody for their name. And it was really, really successful. It really improved we don't have any problems with the rest of the neighbors. That is really different with the rest of the consumption rooms because most of them define themselves as a consumption room. When you define yourself as a consumption room, you are locating the drug use in the center. And the women go there or the people go there, use, and they leave. In our case, they come to do a lot of things. They come to do, as I told you, basic things, taking a shower, clean their room, go to the lawyer, go to the social worker. And also, they can use drugs, but they come to do the rest of the things. And more time that they spent in our place, less use of drugs they have. They really inject less times. They smoke less crack or methamphetamine because one of the main reasons why the women are using in a problematic way is because they have fear, because they are lonely, because they have pain. Then when you are there and you can take care of the rest of the things, the drug use becomes to be not the center anymore. Then we prove that there are other ways to Yeah, to fight against the narco pisos or these places where they use drugs, that they are really, really problematic. And also we show that the women who use drugs are capable to do a lot of other activities and they have a lot of to say. That when you take away the barriers of drug use, they can have a house, they can work, they can do everything that they want. And one of the main barriers that they have is the stigma against them, and not just against women, but also against the drugs. No? Then give knowledge, give the right to put in your body whatever you want, and just give a voice to them and include them in the design, the implementation, the monitoring and evaluation on any of the action that you have. I'm so sorry because it was really accidentally this presentation. One of the things that we have been doing is like, we have been really serious taking the data. Like, this is a really innovative program, but since the beginning, we are keeping track of what we are doing. Not in an intrusive or in an intrusive way. We don't have any kind of interview when they come. They come, they can have a coffee, and after that, when they left, they already leave, we go in front of our computer and we have our own database based on also open source that we can share with any other service is up to date, because normally the data that we were working before was the governmental data that is from 3 years ago. Then we can go to our database, we can talk about motherhood, about their family relationship, about the drug use also, but a lot of different new metrics that normally they are not taken into account. And I have to say that now we have one of the biggest databases around women and gender non-conforming people who use drugs that give us a realistic view about what are the real problems. We don't ask a questionnaire with a lot of questions. First of all, because normally when they come to our place, they lie the first time. They don't trust us because they are really used that most of the resources and the services fail them. And also they know what to do. They know that what information they are expecting you as a professional to know. Then it's important for us to give them the time and they have the freedom to decide when and what they want to share with us, and when they trust us to do it. This gave us different advantages. One of them is that we know that when they explain something to us, it's because it's important for them, because we don't ask, it's not a condition. And also give us a really full view of what are the problems. And what we see is that normally the main problem is housing, is that they don't have any place to sleep. And if you have to be awake all night, for sure you need to use some stimulants. This is for sure. Alcohol for the cold. And also you have a lot of fear. And you don't gonna be able to take a shower. You don't gonna be able to go to look for a work. You don't gonna be able to do most of the normal things that the population is supposed to have to do. Then what we wanted to provide is a safe space, also data to make sure that the decision makers knows what they can find and knows which population are they working with, and also making sure that they are part of all these policies. I don't like to represent their voice. They have their own voice and it's really low and they know what to do and what to say. Then the only thing is that we need to be ready to listen to them and to include them in all the force to improve not their lives but our lives. No? Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks a lot for sharing this very beautiful and very strong story with us. We have a little bit of time for some questions. Maybe we have the micro in the room. Is there a question for Aura? I don't see. Yeah, I have a question here in the middle.
Thank you for sharing and thank you for your work. It's really beautiful. I wanted to ask, this seems like such a necessary space for women everywhere. How did you go about starting that project? How long did it take? What kind of team did you surround yourself with? And if someone wanted to take your example, how would they go about doing it? That's a lot of questions, but...
It's okay. I began, I was coming from Vancouver. I was working there in the consumption room, and I discovered that when we talk about harm reduction, we don't talk about drugs. We were talking about housing, we were talking about a lot of other aspects. I was coming from Barcelona, from one really medicalized consumption room, which was necessary, but I saw that was not enough, no? And we wanted to open this view to talk about the rest of the aspects that we need to take into account. Also in Vancouver, I learned that you cannot do anything about us without us, no? As the drug users also say repeatedly. I moved to Colombia, where I learned how to open the first needle access programs without money. Then we had to be really creative. And I came back to Barcelona to see that the same women that I was working with 8 years ago, they were doing exactly the same thing that they were doing 8 years ago. And I was like, why? If we have like methadone programs, consumption rooms, needle access programs, how is possible that for me the life has been changing a lot? And they are doing exactly the same. Then in 2016, they asked me to do the first research around women who inject drugs using harm reduction services. 2016, the first research around women. I don't know here, but in Spain, we have been using drugs forever and we have been injecting drugs for the past 30 or 14 years. And why I was doing the first research in 2016, I will ask that. Then we had to do this study to empower women. We had to do a workshop to empower women. I don't know you, but I don't get empowered because of workshop at all. But we wanted to do this space where we feel safe and where we share experience. Then we began to meet every week, every Tuesday, for a nice coffee. And just sharing this experience about what was their life with? And most of the conversation were not around drugs, were around other stuff, no? And we began to think, what would we do if we had money? That was something that we never have. Then was then when we began to think about having a safe space and involve women and began to work with the women towards make them believe that other they could do something together, no? That they were not just passive and they were a problem and they had that somebody else had to solve, but that we could be leading the way, no? And it's how we began with the network of women who use drugs. We began to organize ourselves, we began to be present in the community, we began to engage with other activities, like with other social movements, but also trying to talk with other professionals, no, that we felt that they didn't take us seriously. And after a year, we began to have a little bit of money. Then we rented a place, and we went to be like one social educator, me, and a doctor. And little by little, we were showing to the administration that was a cheap initiative, but also with a lot of success. Like when you go there and you say we are 370 women that they were not in contact with the health system and now we are here coming every day and making that possible, the people have to listen to you, at least a little bit. Then it's like that we began to work together, and now we have been recognized as a part of the network for women surviving violence. This is really important because normally harm reduction services are always depending on drug services. We are not. We are depending on the violence against women, of the, sorry, the feminist department in Catalonia, which finally recognize that the problem is not the drugs, is the trauma and is the violence. And we are part of that. It's the only harm reduction services that I know that is part of the network and not from the drug policy aspect. And our team is social worker, lawyer, psychologist, nurses, anthropologist, and community technicians. I don't like to talk about peer workers because who is peer and who is not, no? We can be peers sometimes, we are not. Then I think that one of the things that we need to recognize is the knowledge of the people who life experience and how are them the real, real experts that have to be leading the way.
Okay, thanks a lot, Agagot. No, one question, okay, very, very last one, because I think we've come to the end of the day. I didn't see the question yet. Okay.
I just wanted to ask if you feel supported by a local government, or is this a fully self-funded or privately funded initiative, and also whether there are other people from across the globe interested in your project and wanted to copy this in other cities, or maybe it's even already implemented.
We are mostly, our fundings are mostly public, but not from the Barcelona City Council, but to the Catalan government. We have a little bit of money of the City Council, but just a little bit, maybe to pay for the video or something, but not enough for sure. And we are not sure that next year we're going to be able to survive with the money that we have. Because one of the problems is that they pay for the service, but they don't pay for the structure. Then we have a huge gap about how you're going to sustain the place if you don't have someone that can take care of the administrative work and the other work that is not just providing the service. This is one of our main gaps with the money. And yeah, we don't talk about a service. In fact, when we talk about Medicineras, we are talking more about a model of approach, because it's how you include the women, and you can do that everywhere. And also, we talk about how you view the drug use, no? And how you don't put the drug use as a barrier to not be able to be taken care of, no? Then I think that this model of approach is really interesting, especially in places with low incomes. And yes, there are a lot of people asking us how they can do it in their cities or how they can do it in other places. And we know that in Baltimore they did, and they were really successful because also they had the same problem with not a lot of money, and they wanted to do a place that was friendly, inclusive, and also is an alternative to the medicalized consumption rooms, and is more a community-based. And we also show that we have less bad reaction from the neighbors because we don't include ourselves like a problematic population. We are part of the population, we are part of the neighbor, and we are an active part. Of course, we need to show every day that we are not good neighbors, but the best neighbors, them. We need to be really active with that.
Thanks a lot. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much.